وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى for the next 10 weeks إن شاء الله تعالى we will pause the tafsir of the Quran and we will be doing إن شاء الله تعالى rulings related to transaction, al-kasb, income, money that one makes, and issues related to that, inshallah ta'ala. Every week is going to be a topic, and it's a silsila, it's an ongoing series, inshallah ta'ala. And each of those 10 weeks, we will take, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, 40 to 45 minutes. If it goes on for a bit, then it will be an hour maximum, inshallah ta'ala. But I don't want it to reach an hour. I want it to be less. Half an hour even, the better. Because the point is that the information reaches, and it's not about lengthening something that should be done in a very short, concise sit, inshallah ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters, you all know we're in this dunya. And this dar that we're in right now, this dunya, it's a means to another world. This dunya, it's a means to another world. This world, the scholars, they call it the place where we garden. We have to harvest. And reaping the crops and the fruits is the day of judgment. But in order for those fruits that we reap, those fruits that we pick, the day of judgment, to be juicy, to be good, what is required from us is, whilst in this world, we come with two important traits, two important things. The first thing is, العلم النافع, beneficial knowledge. And the second one is, العمل الصالح, righteous actions. In this dunya, the two things that are required from you and that are needed from you is al-ilmu nafi', beneficial knowledge, wal-amal salih, and a righteous action. Two of those. And if your dunya and this world that you're living in, you come with these two, your akhirah will be al-fawz wal-falah, success and prosperity. The evidence that beneficial knowledge is needed is قوله تعالى, it's the last ayah in Surah At-Talaq. Allah تبارك وتعالى, He says, الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن يتنزل الأمر بينهن لتعلموا أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. Allah tells us in this verse, He says سبحانه وتعالى, الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات, Allah created the seven heavens, and He created the seven earth. اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتِ وَمِنَ الْأَرْضِ مِثْلَهُنَّ يَتَنَزَّلُ الْأَمْرُ بَيْنَهُنَّ. Allah's commandments come down from the sky to the earth. Why is that all being done? Why did Allah create the seven earth? Why did Allah create the seven heavens? Why is Allah's command coming down? Allah says, لِتَعْلَمُوا, so you have knowledge. Of what? أن الله على كل شيء قدير, that Allah has ability over everything, وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما, and that Allah has encompassed everything in understanding and knowledge. So the reason why Allah created all of this, this world and everything that is in it, is that we have knowledge, beneficial knowledge. That is our purpose of why Allah created us. الله الذي خلق. So from the purpose of why we're created is to have knowledge, beneficial knowledge. The evidence to show that we need to come with action is the famous ayah that we all know, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And this ayah is an evidence for righteous action. That Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, I created the jinn. Or more like Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, I did not create the jinn or the ins except to worship me, meaning to come with righteous action. And the best righteous action is to worship Allah alone. Are we all together? Al-ilmu al-nafi' wal-amal al-salih. ولذلك Allah تبارك وتعالى, He told us in the Quran, هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. Allah sent down Nabi Muhammad, not only him but all of the previous prophets, with these two things that I just mentioned: beneficial knowledge and righteous action. هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى. A large quantity of mufassirin, they said, هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى, it means العلم النافع. ودين الحق, they said, it means العمل الصالح. With those two, Allah tells us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. All of the religions, Islam and the Muslims will be apparent over it when they come with those two. Beneficial knowledge and righteous action. You will have the upper hand when you have beneficial knowledge and what? Righteous actions. Allah also says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when talking about the mission of Nabiullah Muhammad and all the other previous prophets, Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الْمَلِكِ الْقُدُّوسِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah tells us that He sent Nabi Muhammad to do what? يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ, teaches them the book, knowledge. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ means what? To bring them to come to righteous action. He's a key, he purifies them, and he makes sure that their action is pure, that they're not associating partners with Allah in their actions. Once they have that, what are they upon? Once the people come with knowledge that the Prophet came with, and they come with righteous action, what does the ayah tell us? هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. They will not be upon clear-cut misguidance. Brothers, this ayah, the last part, is telling us, وإن كانوا من قبل, mankind before this was upon clear-cut misguidance. How is he upon clear-cut misguidance? He had no beneficial knowledge, nor did he have righteous actions. And وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Ibn al-Qayyim said, it connects to the ayah, إِنَّا عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّا عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَأَبَيْنَا يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَأَشْفَقَنَا مِنْهَا وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. Mankind has two traits that Allah تبارك وتعالى created him in: ignorance and oppression. Ignorance goes against knowledge, oppression goes against righteous actions. True or false? وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Before that, they were upon clear-cut misguidance. They were upon what? Clear-cut misguidance. The clear-cut misguidance here means الظُلْمُ وَالْجَهْلُ. It means ignorance and oppression. How can you remove oppression and ignorance? Knowledge and righteous actions. So Ibn al-Qayyim said something very powerful here. Brothers, pay attention. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَ. He said, what is the bare minimum knowledge that is required from everyone to have? What is the bare minimum? Because knowledge is vast. You will die and you will never be able to finish knowledge. What is the bare minimum that is required from you? The bare minimum, he said, is that which brings about certainty. And the bare minimum of righteous action that is required from you is that which brings about sabr, patience. And Ibn al-Qayyim then said, بِالصَّبْرِ وَالْيَقِينِ تُنَالُ الْإِمَامَةَ فِي الدِّينِ. With patience and certainty, you will reach leadership. Because Allah said in the ayah, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Now the question that you guys might ask is that, what does this all have to do with the topic that we're going to talk about? Islamic finance, buyur, buying and selling, requires beneficial knowledge and righteous action. You have to know before you buy or you sell, you have to have knowledge in order for your actions in buying and selling to be accurate. If this dunya that you're living in today, doesn't have those two traits, beneficial knowledge and righteous action, it's the dunya that Allah does not like, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to Allah, it has no value. And Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated in his Sunan, and some scholars they say it's not a Sunan, but it's a Jami'ah. Tirmidhi is not a Sunan, but it's a Jami'ah. Anyways, Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated on the authority of Al-Mustawrid ibn Shaddad. He said, قَالَ كُنْتُ مَعَ الرَّكْبِ الَّذِينَ وَقَفُوا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ Al-Mustawrid ibn Shaddad is a companion. He said, I was with the Prophet. And I was with the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who stood over the caravan. Who were with the caravan. I mean, I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's caravan, sorry. And we were this caravan. We stood over with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala sakhlatil mayitati, over a dead lamb. He said, I, Mustawrid ibn Shaddad, was with Nabiullah Muhammad. And a group of men were with the Prophet as well, when we stood over a dead lamb. Now the Prophet wants to educate the companions. He wants to teach them, and nurture them, and cultivate them. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the companions, "Atarawna hadihi? Do you see this dead corpse? Do you see this dead lamb?" The Prophet grabbed it from the ear and he lifted it. Now remember, brothers, and keep this in mind. This dead lamb is dysfunctional even when it was alive. It wasn't fully, it didn't have its full limbs and full body parts. Okay? So when it lived, it had no value. And now that it's dead, the value has gone even lower, right? The Prophet grabbed it, took it by the ear and lifted it. And he said to his companions, "Atarawna hadihi? Do you see this dead lamb? Hanat ala ahliha. This dead lamb lost value in the eyes of its owners. It became insignificant in the eyes of the people who owned it. Hina alqawha, when they tossed it and they threw it onto the earth like this, it lost value. Qalu, the companions, they said, min hawaniha alqawha. Ya Rasulullah, the reason why they threw it onto the earth like this and they dismissed it and tossed it onto the earth like this is because of it becoming insignificant. It lost value to them. Then the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a statement that we all need to remember. The Prophet said, فَالدُّنْيَا أَهْوَنُ عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ هَذِهِ عَلَى أَهْلِهَا. The dunya to Allah is more insignificant than this dead lamb was to its people. What dunya is this referring to? What type of dunya is this? Is the dunya that lacks and doesn't have in it beneficial knowledge and righteous action. The Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, something even greater, which precisely proves my point, that if this dunya that you're living in does not have beneficial knowledge and righteous action, and you're not coming with that every day, that this dunya that you're living in and your day-to-day income and what you're making is actually cursed. Ala lisani Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is on the tongue of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rawat Tirmidhi, Imam Tirmidhi narrated, وَابْنُ مَاجَةَ مِنْ حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ, on the authority of Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira said what? سَمِعْتُ, I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, الدُّنْيَا مَلْعُونَ, that this dunya is cursed. مَلْعُونٌ مَا فِيهَا, this dunya and everything in it are cursed. And the Arabs and the scholars and the people of knowledge, they said that the word al-la'nu means al-tardu min rahmatillah, that Allah's mercy is distanced from you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who from amongst us doesn't want Allah's mercy? This dunya is cursed and everything in it is cursed. The Prophet gave only two exceptions, beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Look what he said. He said, إِلَّا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ وَمَا وَالَاهَا, remembrance of Allah, which is righteous action. وَعَالِمًا أَوْ مُتَعَلِمًا, or a person of knowledge, a scholar, a learned person, or a person who is seeking knowledge. إِلَّا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ وَمَا وَالَاهَا وَعَالِمًا أَوْ مُتَعَلِمًا, two camps are only mentioned. A people who came with righteous action by remembering Allah in their actions and what they are doing. And the second one is عَالِمًا, a scholar, أو مُتَعَلِّمًا, or a person who is seeking knowledge. If you're not any of those two, you're under those who are cursed. Who is saying this? Nabiullahi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The person, brothers, who buys, who sells, and has no knowledge of what he's buying and selling. He's never studied Islamic finance. He's never studied buyur. He's from the people Allah hates, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He falls under the people Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala hates. Al-Imam Ibn Hibban narrated in his Sahih min hadith Abi Hurairah that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Inna Allah yubghidu. Allah hates, subhanahu wa ta'ala. كل جعذري جواذ. Allah hates a people who have these characteristics. Please listen to these characteristics. Allah hates them. Who are they? كل جعذري. Every individual who's a savage, uncivilized individual. جعذري. A person who's uncivilized. He's a savage in his dealings and the way he is. That's a جعذري. A jawad is yahrisu ala jam'i al-mali bi niyatin fasida. It's a person who tries to bring money together by all means necessary. I need money. I don't care where I get it from, where it comes to me from, and the intent behind it is evil. He either wants to brag and boast to the people, he wants to harm the people. He wants to his money where it comes from, how he attains it. And where he spends it, he doesn't care. He's a jawad. Allah hates him. So the first one was what? A person who's ja'dari, uncivilized. When you deal with him, he has no basic manners. Jawad, he's an individual whose mission in life is to collect money. That's all he lives for. Sakhabin bil aswaqi. He screams and he shouts in the market. My card costs £5, my card costs £5, my card costs £5. He shouts. Allah hates that person who shouts in the market to sell his product. It's a characteristics Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. We see that, huh? A people who have a table in the market. Some of them have even got microphones. And they're shouting in the market. They're screaming. They're raising their voices. And they're repeating in the market the price of their product that they are selling. Allah hates them. Sakhabin bil aswaq. If you want to sell your products with maturity and in silence. Why does everyone have to hear it? If everybody does it, if everybody brings a microphone, what will happen in the market? You can imagine the problem and the hardship it will cause the people. Look at these characteristics. The Prophet goes on to say, "Ajifatin bil layli." When he sleeps at night, he's like a dead corpse. At night, he goes to bed, runs home, throws himself into his bed, and he's like a dead corpse. He wakes up for work. Maybe he doesn't pray Qiyamul Layl, doesn't pray maybe even Fajr. He's a Jifa. Jifa means a corpse. Because the mu'min brothers, even when he's sleeping and he turns around, he makes dhikr. He's aware of his turning and his tossing. This individual is like a jifa, dead corpse. He doesn't know what. Snores through the whole night. Himarin bin nahari, the hadith says. And the way he is in the daytime is like a donkey. Himarin bin nahari. The way he works at the daytime, subhanallah. Subhanallah, carrying everything on his back, pushing it, taking it, hustling, buying, give it to me. What did you get it for? Okay, wait for me. I'm going to run to the market and I'll get you the better price for you. Wait. Runs. Himarin bin nahari. He's a donkey when it comes to his ethics and the way he works. Hard working person. Alimin. He's a scholar. He's reached darajatul alim. He's a scholar in what? Like in bi amri dunya, matters related to this dunya. If you ask him what the different prices are in the market, he will tell you. He knows the currency daily, where they are. Daily currency and the changes of the dollars and the pounds and the euro. He knows all of that. He will check up on that, he will do that. He knows that. Alim, He's a scholar, bi amri dunya. If you ask him about the matters related to the dunya, he will either tell you if a currency is fake or if it's forgery, if it's real money, by looking it from the top, saying, don't bring it to me, don't bring it to me. That's what a man wants to do that. Without touching it, looking it from the top, he said, don't bring it to me, it's not real money, I know what it is. He's alim bi amri dunya. The hadith goes on to say, jahilin bi amri al-akhirah. If you ask him basic issues related to the religion, that he's ignorant, he'll say to you, I don't know, I've never studied. Wallah, it's very hard for me to learn these things, they're very complicated. Complicated? Look how you're good at the multiplications, and look how good you are when it comes to money and detailed issues related to business. You are ignorant about issues related to the akhirah. Has no knowledge. Allah, this person who has these characteristics, Allah dislikes him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does he lack? Lacks knowledge. He doesn't know about the akhirah. And we'll come to that, inshallah ta'ala, soon. Brothers, it's very important that you gain Islamic knowledge related to issues of the deen. And we'll speak about more what we mean by that. But Al-Imam ibn Majah narrated min hadith, min sunnah, fi sunanihi min hadithi Anas ibn Malik, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. Seeking knowledge is a duty upon every Muslim. To gain knowledge, to attain knowledge, is a duty and a responsibility upon every single Muslim. Everyone should learn. Don't go to the market and sell. Don't go to the market and buy if you have no knowledge. ولذلك حسن البصري رحمه الله expanding on the meaning of this hadith, he said the following. He said, العامل على غير علم, the person who acts with no knowledge. He acts with no knowledge. كسالك على غير طريق. He's like a person who's treading a path with no knowledge. A person who's treading a path, he wants to reach somewhere without taking the path for it. Taking the wrong path. وَالْعَامِلُ عَلَىٰ غَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. And a person who works without knowledge, يُفْسِدُ أَكْثَرَ مِمَّا يُصْلِحُ. He will corrupt more than he will bring about any good. The individual who does things, good heart, he wants the best, but he has no knowledge, he will corrupt more than he will bring about any good. Even though he has the intention of doing good, but he doesn't know, so he'll corrupt more. Hassan al-Basri went on to say, rahimahullah ta'ala, فَطْلُبُ الْعِلْمَ. Go and seek knowledge. طَلَبًا, a seeking, لَا تَضُرُّ بِالْعِبَادَةِ, which will not harm your ibadah, your action. Again, look at this. Some people, they seek knowledge, and then it reaches a point that their knowledge has no implementation. So it harmed, the knowledge became an obstacle from their ibadah. You don't see them pray. They don't pray Salatul Duha. They don't pray Qiyamul Layl. They don't remember Allah. They don't have wird, Quran, that they recite daily. They don't have alaqa with Allah Azza wa Jalla in their actions. They're just carrying books all day. Don't let your knowledge harm your ibadah. وَطْلُبُ الْعِبَادَةِ, and then go and seek ibadah. Come with ibadah. طَلَبًا لَا تَضُرُّ بِالْعِلْمِ. Lakin, don't let your ibadah sway you away from gaining knowledge. Some people say, what's the objective of knowledge? This is what they'll say. This is their argument. They will say to you, what is the objective of knowledge? And then you'll say to them, ibadah, righteous action. So I'm already doing righteous action. Why do I need to put myself in a situation of gaining knowledge? Hassan al-Basri is refuting that good claim. Because the same way that action is an ultimate goal, so is knowledge an ultimate goal as well. Both of them. Knowledge, there's an amount that is an objective, as much as there is an amount in actions which is an objective. So don't let your seeking of knowledge get in the way of your actions, and don't let your actions get in the way of what? Your seeking of knowledge. Look what then he said, powerful statement, Hassan al-Basri. He said, فَإِنَّ قَوْمًا, a people, طَلَبُ الْعِبَادَةِ, they went to seek ibadah, وَتَرَكُوا الْعِلْمَ, and they left actions. They left knowledge. There were a people who went and tried to come with ibadah. They tried to come with righteous action, but they didn't seek knowledge. They never sought knowledge. They went and they did ibadah with no knowledge. What happened to them? Hatta kharaju, until they came out bi asyafihim, with their swords. Ala ummati Muhammadin, upon the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were people who just went to actions. No importance to knowledge. It's a waste of time. What do you benefit from knowledge? All you just learn is opinions and views. What benefit does it hold? I don't need that. I just want to do ibadah. And because they only stuck to ibadat, what did it do? Hassan al-Basri said, he said, it reached a point where they came out onto the ummah of Nabiullah Muhammad with their swords, and permitted for themselves the bloods of the Muslims. He said, they're not Muslims, kuffar, 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 kuffar. All because they didn't take the path of seeking knowledge. Hatta kharaju bi asyafim ala ummati Muhammadin. And you look what he said, Hassan al-Basri, walau talabu al-ilma. If they were to go and to seek Islamic knowledge, lam yadullahum ala ma fa'alu. Knowledge will never have instructed them to do such actions. The knowledge, brothers, is two types. The knowledge is two types. There is a knowledge which is called furudu a'yan, individual obligation. Everybody has to know it for themselves. There is a knowledge which every single body has to have. You can't say, oh, inshallah, my local imam, I just call him when I need these questions. La. There is an amount of knowledge that you have to have. This is called furudu a'yan. ولذلك ابن عبد البر he said رحمه الله in his كتاب جامع بيان العلم وفضله he said قد أجمع العلماء على أن من العلم ما هو فرض متعين على كل امرئ في خاصية بنفسه ومنه ما هو فرض على الكفاية إذا قام به قائم سقط فرضه على أهل ذلك الموضع. He said that the scholars unanimously agreed upon that there is a knowledge that is a specific individual obligation. Everybody needs to come with it themselves. There's unanimous agreement upon the scholars that there is individual knowledge that everyone needs to know. What is that knowledge, brothers, that everyone needs to know? We'll come to that. We're going to mention it soon. The second type is فروض كفاية. إذا قام بي بعض سقط عن الباقين. There's an amount of knowledge that you don't have to personally know it. And you can ask your local imam, and he can inshallah ta'ala give you the fatwa, and the ulama and the people of knowledge. فرض كفاية. It's a communal obligation. It's not an individual obligation. If there's amongst the community someone who came with this knowledge, then the obligation is lifted from the rest of the people. But there is an amount of knowledge which is furudu ayan. Everybody needs to come with. Now, what we need, what I want to talk about today is, what is the type which is furudu ayan? From the things which are furudu ayan is that everybody needs to know is the five pillars of Al-Islam. The five pillars of Al-Islam. We all need to know that. You also have to know the six pillars of al-Iman. Al-Arkan al-Iman is sitta. Everybody needs to know that. What does it mean to believe in the angels? You can't say, I don't know. There's an amount of knowledge that you have to have about the angels. Are we all together? The qadr. There's an amount that's obligatory for you to know about it. It's furud a'yan, individual obligation. The third thing that is needed from you is at-tahara. You need to know tahara. How do you do wudu? What are the things that break your wudu? You need to know what is at-tayammum. Women have to know ahkam related to al-hayd, wal-nifas, wal-istihada. What are the difference between these three? And what do you do in each one, each and every one of those situations? What is hayd? How long is hayd for? How do you identify what hayd is? This is an amount which is obligatory upon a woman to know. Furud a'yan. She can't say, no, I don't need to know my imam or my, I know a sister who has this knowledge and I call her. It's an individual obligation. She needs to know this. Also, what the person needs to know is al-muharramatul khamsa. The five things Allah made haram. There are five things Allah stated in one ayah, and they're called the five prohibited things. By the way, these five things that are prohibited were prohibited even in the previous nations. These five things, everybody needs to know them. And it's mentioned in the ayah, Surah Al-Araf, Allah says, قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَأَنْ تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. This is al-muharramat al-khamsa, the five prohibited things. Let's go through them. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ. Allah, He prohibited the fawahish. The fawahish is zina. Number one, Allah prohibited it. Someone can't come as a Muslim and say, I didn't know zina was haram. You have to know that zina was haram. Are you a Muslim? You need to know that. قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ. Fawahish is zina. And the ayah says, مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَن. There's two types of zina that the ayah mentioned. A hidden zina and an apparent zina. What does it mean, the hidden zina and the apparent zina? The Mufassirin, they said, مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ. The difference is the مَا بَطَن, مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا means what the pre-Islamic Arab pagans used to practice, which is once his father dies, if a man's father dies, all of his father's belongings become inherited by the son, including his father's wives. He's inherited. And the son inherits his father's wives. And so he has intimate relationship with the women that his father were married to. And they are what? His mothers. Sahih? So, nikahul ummahat. Ma zahara minha, that's what it's meant by. Wama batana means the hidden type of zina where people don't bring it out in public and they're hiding it. That's it. That's the first one, which is zina. قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ وَالْإِثْمَ. Ithm means what? Ithm is khamar. Ithm here means al-khamar. Everybody needs to know khamar is haram. And Allah prohibited khamar. This is al-muharramat al-khams. Allah prohibited khamar. You need to know that. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ. Ithm is khamar. And Allah prohibited it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Quran and in the Sunnah. And there's an ijma', a unanimous consensus that it's haram to drink khamar or to take in khamar. The third one is al-baghya, transgression. Exceeding your limits, transgressing on someone. Someone called you a fool. You have two choices here. He insulted you, he called you a fool. And this is an insult. You have two choices. You can call him a fool and that's fair. Khalas, stop there now. Or you can forgive him. But to call him a fool and then to say your parents are a fool and your family members are a fool and your whole generation are a fool, this is al-baghi. The ayah is talking about transgression. Someone hit you and you brought a knife out. It's al-baghi, it's transgression. The fourth one is أن تشركوا بالله ما لم ينزل به سلطانا. الشرك. الشرك is just, which is to associate partners with Allah عز وجل. What do? You associate partners with Allah عز وجل. Shirk. This is what? This is shirk. And the last one is وأن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون. القول على الله بغير علم. It is to speak about Allah with no knowledge. It is to speak about Allah with no knowledge. You know what the scholars, they said? The scholars, they said, these five are tasa'udi. Tasa'udi means what? The sins of these five are in the order that they're mentioned in. Meaning it starts from little to high. The five, the first one is the lowest. And it gets worse and worse and worse. And the biggest of them is what? Al-qawlu ala Allahi bi ghayrihi. Even greater than shirk. Because shirk is speaking about Allah with no knowledge. and saying about Allah that which you have no knowledge of, and you don't have no understanding. How can you say Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has a child? Takadu samawati wa tafattarna minhu wa tanshaqqu al-ardu wa takhirru al-jibalu hadda and da'u lil-rahmani walada wa ma yanbaghi lil-rahmani an yattakhidha walada. Say Allah has a child. The creations around you couldn't even handle that. Are we all together, brothers? And the early scholars, rahimahumullah, Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in his kitab, in his I'lam, that غير واحد من السلف, more than one imam from the salaf, they all said, ليحذر أحدكم أن يقول, let one of you stay away from, brothers, stay away from, avoid, and sisters, stay away from, especially social media has this problem. It gives people this platform to speak about the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla with no knowledge. Stay away, غير واحد من السلف. More than one imam from the Salaf said this. Stay away from what? أن يقول أحل الله كذا, to say Allah made this halal. أو حرم الله كذا, or Allah made this haram. Stay away from that. فيقول الله له, and then Allah responds to you when you say that, and He says to you, كذبت, you're a liar. لم أحل كذا, I never made this halal. ولم أحرم, and I never made this haram. Are we all together? That you get a response from Allah where He says to you, كذبت, you're a liar. How are you speaking about me? And saying Allah made this halal and Allah made this haram. And Allah responds to you and He says to you, I never made this halal. Why are you lying for? Or I never made this haram. وَلِذَلِكَ, if you look at the early generation, the Salaf of هَذِي الْأُمَّةِ, the pious predecessors, they used to even avoid the word halal and haram. Because of the ayah, وَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. They used to stay away from saying halal and haram. ولذلك, if you look at the qawal of Imam Shafi'i and Imam Malik and Imam Ahmed and others, they would stay away from saying halal and haram. And so what would they say instead? They would say, أكره. كراها. They would say that avoiding using a akrah means dislike, because they were shy and they didn't want to speak on behalf of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So stay away from them. Also, brothers, one of the things that fall under the furud a'yan, the individual obligation that everybody needs to know, especially the one who is trading and he's doing business, is أحكام المعاملات التي تحصل بينه وبين الناس خصوصا العموم. The dealings that take place between you and the creation, the things that you and the people are doing with one another, the buying, the selling, the dealings that happen between you and people, you have to have knowledge of it. You have to have ilm of it, a perception of it. And those dealings can be dealings related to you and your spouse. You've got a wife, you're married. What you need to do is, you need to learn the ahkam. What is for you and what is against you? Because this is the mu'amalat, it's the dealings, transaction. What can you do and what can't you do? Also, your dealings with your neighbors, that's a transaction. Also, you're dealing with your what? Your business partner, and the business that you're doing, and the contracts that you're signing. And what is this contract based on? Subhanallah, it's ajeeb that you find people, they have consultants, big companies, true or false? They've got advisors who tell them and advise them where they should invest their monies into. Sahih? They will say there's come a nice venture, an opportunity has risen. I'm your personal advisor. I do the marketing, I study the market, I study how money is flowing and where it's all going. I have seen that now the investment should be directed in this particular venture and put it. So he puts his money in there. Lakin, little do you find a person who has a mufti, a person of Islamic knowledge, who sits on that board, who gives fatwa, whether it's halal or haram for them to do this transaction or not. Alaysa kadhalik? Is that not the case? Have a person of Islamic knowledge who sits on the board, who's consulted, not after the dealings has been done, not after the contracts have been signed, before anything has been done. It's been brought to them. And they are taken, their advice is taken on board. And what they point out and what they mention is taken on board. Do many people do that? No. Rather, sometimes, subhanAllah, you see that people will come to you and ask you for a fatwa and a question, and you look at their contract, and you look at their dealings, and you look at the business plan, you look at everything and you realize this has la alaqata lahu bil Islam. This has nothing to do with Islam. And to now try to solve the problem becomes very complicated and hard. Due to what reason, brothers? The whole entire structure in which this business is built upon is wrong. وَلِذَٰلِكَ Look at this. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, لَا يَبِعْ فِي سُوقِنَا إِلَّا مَنْ قَدْ تَفَقَّهَ فِي الدِّينِ رَوَهُ التِّرْمِذِيُّ وَصَحَاحُهُ الْأَلْبَانِي. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sorry, Umar radiallahu anhu said, one should not sell in our market. Do not sell in the market. Do not trade. The market today can be seen as the what? The actual market and also the online marketing as well. لا يبيع. Don't buy or sell. في سوقنا إلا من قد تفقه في الدين. Except a person who has fiqh of these things. Another riwayah, Umar radiallahu anhu said, وَإِلَّا أَكَلَ الرِّبَى شَاءَ أَمْ أَبَى. That person will fall into riba, whether he likes it or not. Because he has no knowledge. He comes to the market, he buys or sells, he's most likely going to fall into riba, whether he likes it or not. He doesn't want to. He doesn't intend to fall into riba, of course. But he will, because he has no knowledge. He has no fiqh of it. Umar radiallahu anhu prohibited that person. Is riba something very light, brothers? Min al-kabair, from the major sins. It's one of the greatest sins, ya ikhwah. It's min kabair al-dhunub, from the great sins. And the person who's trading in riba, what does the sharia say about him? What does the Quran and the sunnah? The people who are doing riba are in a direct war with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Who's going to win that battle, brothers? You're in a fight and a battle with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Mubaraza. The mubaraza, ya ikhwah, is a fight that happens before the real war, the fight starts. Before it kicks off, members come from the two sides and they fight one another, and that's how the fight starts. You and Allah are in direct fight like that. Are we all together, brothers? And you're feeding your children this? Are you going to put this money into their mouth? Ali ibn Abi Talib said something like that. He said, Man tajara. Anyone who trades, قبل أن يتفقه, before he learns buying or selling, before he buys it, ارتطم في الربا ثم ارتطم ثم ارتطم أي وقع في الربا. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, anyone who trades before he has any Islamic knowledge of it, ارتطم في الربا ثم ارتطم. He will fall into riba. Ali's repeating himself 3 times. And so it's important, brothers and sisters, if you have money and you want to trade, you want to do business, فَنِعِمَّهِ, what a good thing that you're trying to do. And it's a blessing that you want to do that. And it's a halal thing that you're doing. Try to find out the ahkam related to buying and selling. At least learn what? Al-buyu'u al-manhiyu anha shar'an. The things that are halal are too much. So you don't need to study what is halal. What do you study at least? The prohibited elements in Islamic finance. At least study what are haram. And the evidence related to that, so you can avoid this. Sahih, brothers? What is prohibited? Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Inshallah ta'ala. Next week we're going to do another portion like that. And this was for today's session, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum.